tell you a little bit about where I'm coming from, you know, what my prior experiences are and why I'm interested in doing professional development like this. So I've worked most of my life as a forensic psychologist focused on juveniles, and in that work came in contact with just the incredible connection between trauma exposure, trauma symptoms, and behavioral and emotional problems. And then I got asked at first about 10 years ago to do a lot of work with correctional officers. And that got me interested in sort of the trickle up effect of what is the cost on professionals that are working with people that are having a lot of acting out due to trauma. And then the latest thing for me has been I've gotten a chance to work on several grants related to police and public safety workforce. And a lot of my consulting work has been with our primarily mental health systems in the Gulf Coast. And before COVID, it was focused on, we have a very high prevalence of individuals with adverse childhood experiences, PTSD, and things like that in our region. And so these were just workforces that were feeling the strain of serving those patients and clients. And in the last year, you can imagine those sorts of questions and overtures have been surrounded on how to deal with the professional strain of working in this new environment. And particularly right now for me, it's with police and paramedic workforce. That's the latest conversations I'm having in our region. And I think for this group, it might be more the public health workforce, but in anyone in health, social and mental health service right now is feeling different versions of stress, unique stress related to COVID. So just to give you a sense of why I'm interested in this, and then I'll share my screen here. Can everyone see that? All right.
It's showing in presenter view, just so you know.
Why? Let's see. New slideshow.
There you go.
That's better. There we go. Okay. Well, the title I chose, I think, was somewhat similar to what I told Rachel, but the word I like for this personally is stewardship. That includes for me leadership, supervision, you know, different tasks that people in health and human services have in middle management and, you know, agency management. But the word stewardship also conveys that to me that we have some responsibility for our workers and for their well-being. It's at least shared responsibility. So I honestly could give the whole talk and just use this slide. That's probably how I do better, but I do have slides that go over most of this. But I do want to take a moment and say this is sort of the map. When you look at the literature on this, and you can think of one part of this is burnout, or another simple good synonym for burnout is really exhaustion, is one consequence of just healthcare work in general. And then what a lot of literature is suggesting is that doing this during a pandemic is just amplifying those normal risk factors for things like burnout. The more extreme concern would be secondary traumatic stress / vicarious trauma, whichever term you prefer. And we'll talk about how to differentiate, understand from what the literature has found, how those are different. And generally speaking, vicarious trauma is seen as sort of a more extreme concern. In very general terms, burnout primarily affects someone's life at their job, mostly. And vicarious trauma is sort of a more severe consequence where that you begin to see effects for that person that are more global for them as a human being and not just in their occupational life. And then the other issue that a lot of my work is involved in, and this is, I think, relevant for the public health and healthcare workforce in the last year, is direct trauma exposure, meaning vicarious would be having to watch someone die on a ventilator, right? Your life is not necessarily threatened by that, assuming PPE and whatnot. But direct is that there is always this thought that even with PPE, even with right procedures, my own mortality may be affected as a worker in this pandemic. The other direct trauma exposure that we're unfortunately hearing more about is with public health workers and public health officers is direct threats towards them, even threats of death, harassment, doxing, things like that. So those are not vicarious, those are direct trauma exposures. My work right now is with paramedics and police. Obviously, they often have a lot of direct trauma exposure where their life is directly threatened, and they have vicarious exposure where they're seeing people injured, seeing people dying, and things like that. And the last two things I'll probably allude to in this is moral injury and betrayal trauma. So moral injury refers to very generally that sometimes our work, the procedures of our work, the realities of our work in healthcare means that our own moral values have to be compromised in order to do things within a standard of practice, in order to do things within a company's standards. Maybe there's other external constraints that force you to make compromises with your value system. And there's a quite viral video that came out last year by a YouTube physician. I'm not going to play it, but I have a slide where I allude to it, that I think makes the case that we really maybe should be talking about burnout differently in terms of moral injury, is that people aren't burnt out because they have some flaw as a professional. They're burnt out because they're working in systems that are injurious to them psychiatrically or emotionally. And then the last part that's sort of related to moral injury is betrayal trauma. So betrayal trauma is a concept that comes up in many different sets of research. For example, some of my work is with rape and sexual assault survivors. And it's interesting, they and police officers have betrayal trauma in studies. They have this set of traumatic reactions that are really about powerful forces that around them have not met their duty to them. So that's a concern. And then this idea of stewardship is that as leaders, as policymakers in healthcare, if we fail in that duty, one of the things we create is this sense of betrayal by professionals and workers to the very systems they work for. And that can be really insidious, meaning we get past the pandemic, but if something people learn from the pandemic is that the systems they work in don't have their back, they can't support them. I was just on a national presentation where I talked about sort of this topic, and then the two following speakers were an officer who had been a special victims unit officer and then a nurse. And they talked about the experiences they had had that it had them leave those professions that had to do with some of their mental health concerns that came up from doing that work, years of exposure to traumatized people, and then the inability of their employers and their systems to kind of support them in that. And if you think about it, it's really insidious. That betrayal trauma means that even if you stay in the profession, your schema for the profession may be forever changed. You may never be able to get the sense of meaning and that you previously got. So I'm going to go through in more detail, but this is kind of, you know, just if you only listen to one part, this is an overview at least here. And I'm going to try to talk about some ideas about how we stem the tide on some of this. So I'm going to go over what these things are, and I'm going to move pretty fast because I want to get to the things that have to do with leadership and organizational change. So burnout can be broken down into three components: emotional exhaustion, depersonalization, and reduced accomplishment. The emotional exhaustion is pretty self-explanatory, as is reduced accomplishment. The depersonalization is sort of the special sauce of this. The way we understand burnout is you have an overwhelming amount of obligations in your workplace, and particularly thinking of healthcare workers. Not necessarily traumatic obligations, just burdens, having to do mountains of paperwork, listen to people that are not always very nice, which I know public health workers are probably dealing with a lot of that now. And the way we understand this is the way you cope with that is depersonalization. Synonyms for depersonalization might be like cynicism, detachment. Another concept here is that we people develop a defensive style of practice in the healthcare profession or any profession. They begin to approach the work and having to take care and protect their emotional state by distancing themselves from the work. So depersonalization means you view the patient as dehumanized. You view, you're almost sort of like asleep while you're on the job, so to speak. You're keeping everything at an emotional distance. And that's trying to limit this encroaching exhaustion and maintain some sense of accomplishment. But what happens is the more you become depersonalized, the less you can feel any sense of accomplishment. So you have to distance from the work. You can no longer be good at the work. So you find that people that are burnt out, they get their supply of sense of esteem and meaning through finding other people in a system that are experiencing these same things. So the classic example is, you know, working in I did a lot of work in emergency rooms in the late 90s, and you would see these professionals doing amazing work when people came in. And the way they coped was they go to the water cooler and they talk in the abhorrent ways about all the patients they serve. And that's sort of a sign of burnout, right? That you can't really stay emotionally connected to the work, so you have to find places to vent about it. But that might reduce your sense of accomplishment over time. It's not highly professional. It's not something that allows you to leave the day feeling full. We can think about burnout longitudinally, that it starts with enthusiasm or romanticism and leads through these stages, and it kind of ends in apathy. So burnout ends in sort of indifference, cynicism, apathy. You're pushing away from that work as a way to survive. You know, we know a lot about the causes. If you'll note here, I'm not going to go through all of them, but there are internal causes, obviously. So we can look at it from what are the personal vulnerabilities a professional brings, but also external causes. How much discretion you have in your job, how much support, obviously, you have from supervisors, coworkers, peers, and how much meaningful, positive interactions you might have with the people you're serving. So a combination of all those things can kind of get us there. Another way to look at the causes is this idea of mismatches. So burnout can be understood as sort of a person-environment incongruence. You have certain values that are a mismatch for the job. You have certain desires for certain rewards. Maybe that's financial, maybe it's existential meaning, and they don't line up with the job you're doing. But this is, I think, the best way to think of it is this mismatch between the worker and the setting they're in. And it helps us understand why some people in a certain setting do great and aren't bothered by this, and why other people might be in the same setting and have a completely miserable time and have a difficulty getting the work done. When we look at the impact of burnout, it primarily the literature focus on that it makes work harder, and we have a lot of concerns we want managers and leaders to be aware of is why we should care about this, is it affects the bottom line, affects patient care and healthcare, but obviously it affects the worker themselves. And so this sort of gets at all those things. One of the things here, generally speaking, is that it seems that when people have burnout, when they're removed from that work environment, it tends to go away, right? So burnout is not necessarily in the research something that is sort of becomes a stable problem for the worker. Once we see some shift, either their workplace changes or they change jobs, it tends to go away. So even though they may have some personal risk factors, like they're a little neurotic and anxious, if we get them in a better situation contextually, this state of affairs changes. When we get to vicarious trauma, that's not necessarily true. So I mentioned the idea of defensive practice here, that one of the chief occupational problems with burnout is in healthcare, you have to adopt a defensive approach to serving people. And you can think of that as an avoidant coping strategy. I'm just trying to protect my limited emotional well-being. And the way I do that is I kind of make the patient the enemy, and they're the source of the stress, so I limit them. What's really sad about that is in a lot of the research, when you tease it out, it's really that usually that negative emotion is coming from contextual factors related to colleagues and supervisors, that the person usually attributes it to the patient, but it isn't always the patients that are. So in a lot of the research, when we do that, we end up cutting ourselves off from a source of remoralization, which is serving patients well and having a chance at interactions that are rewarding in that regard. So when professionals decide the patient's the cause and the enemy, we make that attribution. We begin this depersonalization and defensive practice style. And because it's really hard to ask your coworkers to be better and your supervisor to be better. So you sort of, it flows downhill to the patient, but then that robs them of their sense of accomplishment and meaning. In terms of vicarious trauma, this is my personal little chart. My way of understanding it, I mean, my own reading of this years ago, this is how I frame this in my head, is that, you know, you think of burnout as being worn out. Burnout is exhaustion. Both burnout and vicarious trauma are related to personal factors and job factors. The difference is that vicarious trauma is not just exhausted, it's activated, scared, traumatized, freaked out, anxious. And vicarious trauma, we understand, is due to exposure to the traumatic material of the people we're serving. And or your own direct threats you might experience as a professional, which again are happening now, unfortunately. So these things are overlapping, but they're different. The bottom line, these can both be happening at the same time. The end result is that we tap out, right? If the problem with burnout is that people can stay burnout and do the job, they just do it in that defensive, depersonalized way. People with vicarious trauma, it is a state of affairs that affects them as a human being. One of the terms you'll see in that literature is schema alteration. So burnout doesn't modify your underlying, thought structures of how you view your work, yourself. Vicarious trauma can end up changing how you view yourself as a human being, not just professional. and changing how you view your whole outlook on life. So it's just a very destabilizing experience. So it's generally seen as more severe. And the second bullet here is really important, that vicarious trauma, our empathy, our compassion in the research is one of the mediating risk factors. So in fact, professionals in healthcare that have a higher level of dispositional empathy are often in research at the highest risk of these vicarious trauma symptoms and problems. So that's a problem because most healthcare, not all, some degree of bedside manner, empathy, warmth, perspective taking is kind of seen as required for delivering services effectively. Again, that's not across the board. I don't really care if my surgeon, you know, understands how I feel, but most healthcare, we might say that's an important thing. But that very skill, those soft skills, that emotional intelligence, it is part of why you develop vicarious trauma, because you can't disconnect enough from that material. And then the idea that this ultimately affects broad-based schemas of how you view yourself, the world, other people, not just your job. Always like this quote is, vicarious trauma is the transformation in the inner experience of the provider that comes about as a result of empathic engagement with the client's trauma material. So think of this as similar to PTSD. More mentioned moral injury. So I'm not going to play this video. It's a little too long, but I'm happy to share the PowerPoint, and this is embedded in there. And this is a physician, Dr. Zubin, that has a YouTube channel and talks about health policy issues and whatnot. This got millions of hits about a year ago, right before the pandemic. And basically the slides after it explain somewhat aligned with his thesis. But basically it's that burnout should really be viewed as moral injury. So then what is moral injury? So if we think of this, Dean and Talbot have a great paper on this, looking at physicians, for example. And it argues that the state of affairs is that, you know, healthcare providers have a set of moral values. They're forced to either commit or support or bear witness to acts in their work that violate their values. And then the cost of that is that they lose their integrity, right? So you become, this sense of yourself has to be compromised sometimes to get the job done. And that manifests as what we call moral injury. So when we have to make those sacrifices, in psychological terms, we experience cognitive dissonance. So my sense of my right and wrong is now in conflict with what I'm witnessing or being asked to do. And I have to resolve that tension, that anxiety. And so I have two options. I can either reject the realities of my job, right, and adhere to my own values. So most network television about healthcare chooses route one. There's like five shows on TV right now that are all basically physicians fighting the good fight and rejecting the industrial late capitalism values of their employers. Or two, we modify our values. So we have to get rid of that tension. The problem is both those choices. Number one leaves you in this constant, you know, quixotic battle with the industry and with systems, and two, leaves you as you've lost your own sense of self as a moral being. And that causes psychological problems for people. That's a long-term chronic state of affairs that that is another way to understand this sort of workplace stress topic we're talking about. Another reason why this is an important view is it's a reframing of burnout. And it suggests that burnout puts the blame on the professional. Moral injury takes a systemic perspective on the problem. And I want to talk briefly about individual strategies. I'm not a huge fan of talking about individual strategies because I think they can be a bit of a cop-out, but they're obviously relevant. But when a worker, when a public health worker, physician, nurse are experiencing this, what might they do? And I don't think these are particularly interesting usually either, but I try to cover them. We have the cognitive route. We try to shift our perspective, reframe things, try to focus on the things that are good in your day. You know, I, as a supervisor of psychologists, I'm totally guilty of that with my subordinates and trying to help them, you know, grab onto that patient that was a great experience and the other eight were miserable, but hold on to that one that was good. There's the sort of personal well-being approach, whether that's cognitive, emotional, like spirituality, family, interpersonal support, finding purpose, or it's more physical, recreation, physical activity, sleep. As not surprisingly, a lot of the research suggests that, you know, you can handle jobs like this amazingly well if you can just get 6 to 8 hours of sleep every night. So those are all pretty obvious things that people can do. And you'll see that in the literature on burnout, vicarious trauma, things like that. These all, when you think of this though, from a moral injury point of view, these sometimes people will find to ring somewhat hollow. Because if it's a systemic problem, these are all strategies that are left for the worker to implement. And that leaves you feeling like, well, this isn't enough. The main thing from the literature on what can individual workers do is active coping, that we want to have we don't want to be passive. We don't want to be avoidant. We want to help professionals choose a strategy, self-assess, choose a strategy and enact it. And it has to be something that's active. Sometimes we want to sell them on the benefits of that. So we call that psychoeducation with burnout and intervention is trying to help a professional understand if we can do these things, things will get better, you'll feel better. So like internal health promotion offices in healthcare, often, you know, you'll see them trying to promote some education and helping people see that things can be better if you'll just try these things, right? Again, it's somewhat hollow in that if it's a systemic problem, this probably isn't enough, you know? Another strategy is cognitive, is helping people think about, look, you can't control all of this, you know, sort of the serenity prayer approach. You can only control certain things. How do we, you know, again, identify things in our work that we can find hopeful? In my little world right now, I have several, you know, working on a huge grant with sexual assault nurse examiners. This is all their side gig. They're all ICU nurses. They've all seen hundreds of people die in our city. And this is what they talk about is like, well, this will end. It'll be different. We'll get back to normal. But then what I hear talking to them is like, but the normal wasn't so great to begin with in their work. So that they're struggling to hold on to that hope. But then again, bring in the moral Lindsay perspective. One of the things that may sustain people is how do you get back to your integrity? What is important to you about your job? Where are your lines you're willing to draw? You know, and I'm working with that group, and that's a lot of their struggle is they really value that working with rape victims, but it's all a side gig in our system. We don't have a dedicated office for that. So they're engaging in a lot of advocacy as a group of 12 nurses, arguing upward in our system for they'd like to, you know, some of them to do this as their dedicated role as a nurse. That would appeal to their sense of integrity and purpose and things like that. It's a lot of literature on peer support with burnout and workplace stress intervention. This is actually, I would argue, way more evidence for this as a useful strategy than there is for getting workers to adopt individual strategies. So when we think about peer support, we know some things from the research that's been done. First of all, how do we define it? It's not just having a peer that delivers help. It's training workers to both seek support and help in an intentional way from colleagues, but also having each person see themselves in their professional identity as I'm also someone who provides that support, that it's mutual. It's not that you assign one person in an organization to be the internal counselor with no training in counseling. These models you often see will train healthcare and other professionals in some basic facilitation skills, but more train them in just a way to think about their role as a colleague. And a lot of peer support programs are trying to reframe for everyone in an organization how they view what collegiality means. And that simple idea of a system of giving and receiving or reciprocity is a key idea that seems to be effective in some studies. So other principles you can see when we look at peer support programs is that they're personalized. We want to, you know, teach people to support their colleagues in a way that's specific and personalized. So simple things like teaching them when you listen to a colleague ask to have a session with you and you guys talk, you want to give feedback that's not abstract, not platitudes, but that's specific to your colleague, you know, and often you're not a counselor, so you can give advice, you can use what you know about them, but try to be specific and individualized. We want it to be trauma-informed. We want it to be teach people to support each other in ways that don't re-traumatize one another. So helping colleagues have some basic template of avoiding statements that stigmatize, that are judgmental. And that's hard to do when half the folks you're talking about are in that state of depersonalization and burnout, when they're not really excited about taking up these activities. So one of the challenges in implementing peer support is what do you do with the workers that's sort of too far gone and they can't really do a trauma-informed reaction to a colleague. Their reactions are inevitably pretty sarcastic and caustic, and they just aren't very good at that point at being supportive. All the programs that have been studied are voluntary. This is not the worst thing to do is like have a draconian, everybody's got to sit down and be supportive. So it's always like forming collegial dyads that are voluntary and self-selected, hopefully organic, and reflect existing ties among people in a given organization. And obviously that these peer support models teach people to be empathic and to collaborate with each other. We teach them that they're not the expert on their colleague, and they don't have to be the expert on themselves if they're the one asking for some collegial feedback and support. One of the criticisms of these models, though, like the individual strategies, is this sort of leaves leadership, it gives them an out, right? So clinical and administrative leaders don't necessarily have a clear role in this. And most of the models, they're discussed. We ask them to, you know, get behind these efforts. It has to be supported. But what it doesn't include is like, well, what do leaders need to do themselves to help stem the tide of these sorts of problems? So, well, the thing I really like talking about is this, and what I mean by supervision is like on the ground supervision in a healthcare environment of a provider. And I know not everybody's a provider. Many people work in healthcare, but they're not providers. But then also just general leadership in health and human services and mental health settings. What role do leaders have in this battle of trying to keep this stuff from, you know, destroying these professions, particularly right now? So really quick, it's the old model of clinical supervision. This is definitely from my field in mental health. It's by a British psychologist named Proctor. And very, very simply, if you look here, it's formative, restorative, and normative roles of supervisors. So normative is the managerial, ensuring you did your charting, ensuring you were on time for work, that you stayed within the policies of the hospital, agency, organization. Formative is educative supervision, where someone has a skill gap and we're trying to train them in that. That could be supervising somebody that's finishing their education in healthcare. It could be that you're overtraining and development for a hospital and you're putting together training experiences. What most literature in all health and mental health and social service professions, what seems to be missing when we look at it is this idea of restorative supervision. And basically, in a nutshell, that's the idea that a part of what supervisors need to be doing is caring a little bit for the person that they're supervising, having some interest in them as a human being that is a professional and not simply as them as a professional. So what you find in the research is when we have supervisors in the wild that this restorative component's missing, you have much higher, lower rates of skill acquisition, you have much higher rates of attrition in that profession, and a lot more indicators in a given setting of burnout, trauma, workplace stress symptoms. So one of the inoculations against these problems we're talking about is this ability to get supervisors, I don't really mean leaders here, I mean people that are actually doing the supervisors, the middle managers of healthcare, to develop some soft skills in this area of restorative supervision. The worst thing though is having a supervisor that doesn't have the neurons for this, and they sort of end up trying to parrot it and just pretend to be super, you know, that doesn't work very well. So the other issue is we have to kind of be careful at selecting people for supervision roles that have some disposition towards a supportive or restorative approach to supervision. And not everybody does. And that can be a huge challenge. So a few more ideas about this is that if we can mount this effort, there's evidence that it does lead to in part reductions in burnout and secondary stress. Part of supportive supervision is though being educated as a supervisor that your workers are engaging in emotional labor as part of their job. They are exposing themselves to stressors. So if you don't have a trauma-informed education yourself, you may try to be supportive, but you're going to do it from a place of ignorance and you're not going to often hit the mark. And other points we want to make sure supervisors understand is that this is sort of in settings right now, let's say in COVID, there's this double and triple burden on providers. They have all the normal stressors of doing whatever their job is in healthcare. They have unique stressors due to COVID. And if they have supervision in which the supportive stance is absent, so think of this as these compounding variables that if we can start removing some of those, we get a better situation. We can't remove the pandemic. We can't, you know, change that completely yet. But what we can do is control the nature of the supervision, oversight and support that they're receiving, you know, and the argument here is that this is absolutely a necessity. If there's tons of research, I don't have time to go into today, that the burnout rates are unacceptably high across all healthcare professions. And obviously the preliminary research right now is that they've in some cases doubled, you know, we're up to 70-80% on some samples of people experiencing this. The evidence before the pandemic was that these rates were already going up globally. in most healthcare professions in the United States and elsewhere. So we started this whole thing not doing too great, and obviously this has made it a whole lot worse. So the argument here is that, you know, supervision practice has a role to play in reducing this, but that supervision has to be viewed, its own supervisors have to see themselves in a systemic and organizational context. So when you supervise people, you can respond to their emotional struggles and needs to some degree. At some point that may be, look, you need to go to the EAP, you need to see somebody yourself, certainly. But you have to have some ability to respond to that. However, you also have to understand you're working in a system that has certain strengths and weaknesses and vulnerabilities, certain culture to it. And to be an advocate for those workers, when, for example, you have a 7-8 people you're actively overseeing, and you know that there's a pattern across all of them that has nothing to do with them as individuals, that has everything to do with the nature of that organization, clinic, hospital. What is supervisor middle management's role in providing advocacy and feedback upward? And obviously that's a tough question, because that involves vulnerability and exposure. But it's a moral question about what is supervisor's obligation in that regard. And this slide is just pretty much everything I just said. So this last bullet kind of sums it up. We don't just want to shelter the supervisee from the vagaries of where we work. Ultimately, the goal should be to try to change those vagaries, try to change that systemic setting. If we know that there's things that are regularly producing occupational casualties, and try to address those. And that is challenging when some of these risk factors are simply things we can't change. They're just baked into the work. So the last part of this is talking about trauma-informed organizations, you know, moving past supervisors to, like, what do we know about what organizations that are good at this do? First of all, when we look at, like, the trauma-informed care literature, I don't have time today to go into the history of trauma-informed care, but it comes out of work mainly in mental health with highly traumatized populations, child abuse situations, women's domestic violence shelters. And it's sort of making its way into nursing in particular, corrections, the VA. So you'll see this, it's been about 2 decades of scholarship and policy work on what does this mean. But the one thing in every instance we mean by trauma-informed care is an organizational culture shift. It's not just providing, you know, vacation days to workers. That's great. It's not just providing health promotion resources to workers. It's not just even supervisors being nicer, having a better bedside manner. It involves the organization engaging in regular self-reflection on its practices and procedures and the ways in which those practices and procedures add stress or trauma even onto their staff, and how ultimately those practices and procedures limit or impair our ability to serve patients. So it's just the trickle-down theory here that if we cannot lead from a humane, moral place, then we can't expect providers to do that. And then we can't expect that patients ultimately are going to receive the highest quality services, particularly patients that are presenting with psychological trauma concerns, either as their primary concern or as an ancillary concern alongside a basic medical issue. So that's kind of like in 2 sentences what trauma-informed care is. But the key here is this idea of parallel process, that if we cannot expect services downstream to be any better than leadership upstream. And that's not a particularly revolutionary idea, but I think it's one that for various reasons has been really pushed in different health and social service sectors the last couple of decades. So it's a culture change. So the provider, whoever the provider is, whatever they're doing in healthcare, their relationship with their supervisors affect how much they're gonna see the organization as a whole as fair and just. So again, those middle managers have to see themselves as representing a larger entity in their engagement with subordinates. The agency as a whole, examples of policies that in research have been used to reduce the levels of burnout, secondary stress, is looking at caseloads, not the amount of the caseload, but the composition of the caseload when it's possible. So this might be where, you know, I've worked with agencies where somebody's doing 30 hours of clinical contact a week, and it's all with people, veterans with polytrauma. So they've got a head injury, physical disability, and severe PTSD. Is there a way to balance that caseload? Because that may be too much dose for any single professional to deal with, right? There's examples of that, I think, in the COVID world, where having, you know, giving one person the job of hearing from all the angry citizens that week might not be a great idea if we can avoid it. if we can't avoid it, how do we offer additional supports? So how do we triage and know which of those workers are getting the biggest dose? And we might need to individualize an approach to detect that and offer supports, respite time, additional sick leave, things like that. Obviously encourage self-care, but again, my view is that alone isn't gonna cut it. You can think about this from a staff development point of view, and a lot of the literature points to that most studies, when we look at our healthcare workforce, they often get stereotyped as cynical and burnout, but they often will tell you in research that they want professionalization, they want regular feedback, they wanna know where they stand in their work, and they want formal ways to get social support, right? And a lot of my work, and maybe you're having different experiences, is people in healthcare telling me that it's sort of a lost cause, their workers are just sort of checked out, they get the job done, but only, you know, at the crack of a whip, so to speak. And that's just is totally at odds with every piece of research that I can consult about what people end up in the workforce. Like when you offer them ways to get better, the evidence is people will take it. If it's formal, they see you mean it and they see that it's not gonna be a one shot. This is gonna be a shift in how we do things. You can get people to buy in. So this slide and next is just this idea of parallel process, is that if patients or clients, and I apologize for clients, I'm a psychologist, we say clients. If clients feel all these things, then probably that trickles up to staff, trickles up to organization, but then the opposite is true as well. That if the organization is feeling all these things, you can bet, and when you look at it, that the patients are probably experiencing all those things downstream. So we think of this as a trauma-organized system, that systems organize around the stresses of the work they're doing. Again, prior to COVID, you would see this in VA hospitals, and I do a lot of work with child advocacy centers that only serve traumatized children. And you often find the organization over time has become itself, if you think of the organization as a person, itself traumatized. So the organization is highly reactive, it's toxic, it has very few places of emotional safety in it. Communication is broken down because everybody's engaged in this avoidant defensive practice, and a high level of conflict has ensued. So at its worst, this sort of process ends up that the entire organization can't approach actively points of stress and address them. That the entire organization, leadership on down, is in basically a PTSD state and avoiding triggers, basically. And you can, obviously, that's not a good state of affairs. You can't get much done. The other thing that happens here is one of the ways we cope when the entire organization is just overwhelmed is we fall back on really hierarchical management structures. We can even become quite authoritarian and autocratic because that will temporarily get the job done, but it's kind of like putting a lid on top of a boiling pot of water. Long-term probably isn't going to work. There's this inability and inflexibility to address the enormity of the problem. And so we can't even get down to how this is affecting workers or patients on a really humane level, because we can't really even get past just the basic day-to-day, you know, scheduling and getting the job done. That itself feels overwhelming in organizations like this. And so these are really tough situations. And so a lot of talks like this is like, how do we keep from getting to this place? And I imagine there are plenty of places right now that despite their best efforts, we're already there and we can't really get out of it. So we know a lot about what makes resilient organizations as well. We talked a lot about this already, so I'm not gonna go through all of this, but some highlights here is, again, is there a formal implementation of some sort of peer support? Is there formal training and support and accountability for supervisors to mount some of their effort to be in that supportive, restorative mode? You know, do we train our supervisors and middle managers to do some things that communicate, you know, concern and care for the person that's working for them? Things like retreats, staff appreciation, again, those are nice. They're probably not systemic enough, but they don't hurt. Staff development and education, giving staff a choice in that, and also tailoring and triaging staff development within a healthcare organization to different nodes. Not everybody needs the same thing, right? We might all need sexual harassment training and stuff like that, but depending on what a node is doing, they might need a more particular, and getting staff input into what kind of training they want. And to not be stuck in that mode of thinking, they all sound burnout, they sound so they don't want the training and I'm not gonna, you know, we gotta give people what they need, not what they want. So people that are burnout, the things that they're gonna want are not ever going to be good because they're in a place of, I'm just treading water. So I just want a life raft or I want a Mai Tai, you know? They're not gonna ask, but that doesn't mean that we as leaders need to be totally bound to that. We need to have an understanding of that's where they are. How do I, you know, engage with them in a way that's going to get them out of that place? One of the things to talk about here that's somewhat unique to this current space you're maybe all in is that we're in the midst of a crisis. And I think I missed this slide. And what do we do once it's over, right? And there's not a lot of research on this. There's a lot of dialogue happening. And one of the things to point out is there's a risk of all these problems actually worsening after this particular crisis is over, depending upon whatever that professional might have been doing. So some examples of this is in our community. This is a picture from our community. We have our vaccination protocol. Everyone drives into the Civic Center, literally drives in, and people give the vaccination, and they wait for the 15 minutes. And you know, I've done a couple of focus groups with our public health just as a favor to our public health director. And what I heard there from a lot of the nurses and LPNs was it was really a rewarding experience, right? Obviously, it's a self-selected population of people that wants the vaccine. It's kind of an interesting, fun experience. They drive in the Civic Center, you know, and then they sit and chat with the nurses while they're waiting. And it wasn't a horrible, bad experience. And in fact, it was the one thing for them. All the stuff leading up to that had been responding to calls from the public that think they're all conspiracy theorists and think they're trying to put chips in their brain. And this was great. And they're really, the morale is really high. But our public health director was saying, well, what happens though when this is over? And the day-to-day work they usually do isn't something like that. It's not as stuff that's so moralizing. And how do we help them sort of reset back to normal? Obviously, the other examples you see, and I'm sure you're all seeing, is where it's not been a rewarding experience and you're dealing with the public, you know, angry, yelling at you and things like that. In either case, one, because you've had a great experience and you want to sustain it, and that may not be possible. In the other, you're sort of traumatized and burnt out and just looking for relief, and we need to get back to normal, and you may not have the emotional energy to do that. So on both fronts, sort of after a crisis, you can see both those versions happening. And how do we, you know, reinforce everyday professionalism for both groups of people, either the really stressed people or the people that have had a good experience and they think this is going to be what their job's like from now till forever? Is how do we, and I think the only way is to be intentional and say it out loud and be talking about this. One thing is I've done with some of my partners is using outcome data and how much we gather in healthcare, but we don't share back with workers in any meaningful way. We've done a lot with simple things like making infographics that the average frontline person can understand, but that helps them to have a sense that they're part of something larger, helps them have a sense that their day-to-day professionalism is leading to some bigger outcome. So I think in this current space, like making sure we communicate back with workers about the impact we've had. Much of it's been difficult, but you know, much of public health has done an amazing thing in the last 6 months to a year. And then starting to have supervisors actively talk about that these extravagant acts of heroism and martyrdom, it's probably not going to be standard everyday practice. And we got to talk about that out loud. And then lastly, it's a crisis. There needs to be debriefing and processing opportunities. We cannot just go back to healthcare as normal. There needs to be some discussion to providing intentional, deliberate spaces for workers to talk about this in a formal way, because they are talking about it. If we don't give them a space, they are going to shape that conversation on their own. And again, go back to what I said about what happens is all the burnout people tend to find each other. There's an old psychology finding that basically summarizes is that misery loves miserable company. It's not that people are miserable, just love any company. They want other miserable people because that's congruent. So if leadership doesn't get in this game, professionals find each other and they create their own reality as things go forward. And that may or may not be a good reality when you think about it. So I've stopped. I want to leave a little bit of time. I think I've hit the mark here, but I'd love questions. Hopefully I've spurred some thought and we can do a little bit that's not just on a PowerPoint at the end here.
Thank you, Trey. I thought that was fantastic. So while people are putting questions in, remember you can use the chat function or the Q&A function. I thought just maybe a question from me. I think when we think about trauma, we tend to think about like those big T traumas is what
yes.
I've heard them called, you know, like war or terror events or things like that. we don't always think of the little t trauma of the day-to-day. Yeah. Maybe that's where that burnout falls into. So I think changing that approach to how we look at trauma is probably an important part.
Yeah, a common reaction. I started really wanting to do more outreach and professional development around this about a decade ago. And I remember giving a talk to a bunch of child welfare physicians, social workers, and nurses. And they all said, you keep talking about trauma, but nothing on there is trauma. And because their view was like, I work with kids that were raped, or I said, no, all of that, let's that's a great conversation. There is, you can think of certain traumas as, so to speak, more unconditioned stimuli, right? Threats to your life and that any mammal would find as, but we have really big verbal brains. So there's these other smaller T traumas that are usually less frequent, but they accrue over time. And I think that what changed the conversation for me was about a decade ago, the adverse childhood experiences research. And that allowed a different conversation about, if we don't want to call those traumas, so if you're not familiar with that, it came out of Kaiser in California. And they found that they were doing a workplace study and people that has had these adverse experiences as children, as they added up, a multitude of health outcomes got worse in this big sample, including mortality. But none of these things themselves were physical risk factors. They were having your parents divorce, being abused, living, ever being homeless at any point. So that sort of perspective, I think, gives us a window. If you think about workers from that point of view, workers have their own version of that. Maybe they've never had, I mean, I have officers I work with, they've never been shot at, they've never been threatened, but they have what looks like almost full-blown PTSD symptoms because of that accrual of these small T traumas over time and in the absence of any way to cope with them.
Interesting. Well, we've got a couple questions that have come in on the chat.
Sure.
Let's go. The first one says, where in the process of supporting people through a traumatic incident like the COVID crisis, would you initiate a CISD, and who should be initiating it, the staff or the supervisor? Or is a CISD even appropriate for something like this?
So I've done this talk for four different places in the last few months, and that's insane. I get this question every time. So critical incident stress debriefing. So there's the research based on this is quite fraught. Generally speaking, when it's done with lay populations, it's iatrogenic, right? That's the main effect we find. When we do CISD is in the immediate aftermath of an acute exposure, we provide opportunities for people to talk about. And the idea is that it's exposure therapy, right? That you are re-experiencing that in a supportive environment, we're making that experience less emotionally destabilizing. So one thing is, you have to, if you're going to be evidence-based, I don't think there's any support for doing it with lay populations. There's some research out there with nurses and firefighters where it doesn't seem to be harmful, and it actually seems to be helpful though. And we're not clear on why. I think one of the theories is that people that have some degree of training in a service sort of profession seem to be to know what to do with that. Like, they can titrate their own exposure a little better because you're in a job where you kind of have to know how to do that. So the other model though, that I would say has the most support is psychological first aid. So not that it should compete with stress debriefing, but PFA is, SAMHSA has sponsored a lot of the research on that. I can in a minute put a link in the chat. And that model really starts out with the first thing we should do is not debriefing, but think about basic safety, emotional and physical safety. So the physical safety may or may not always be a relevant issue in a healthcare worker sort of situation. But like, for example, it is an issue in the public workforce or public health workforce, where you have people that have literally been our director of public health, who's a former CDC investigative officer. She has had 17 different death threats in Mobile, Alabama in the last year. So if I were working with her, I would not be immediately saying, let's start having you talk about it. I'd be saying, do you have a bat phone to a captain in the police force? Do you have a sense of how your security is going to be handled? Where is your family? So PFA argues, with a lot of research backing, that that's the first step. The other reason we do that is based on a lot of research on traumatology, psychological traumatology, is that most people, the majority, within 6 weeks of an acute exposure are back to baseline without any intervention, right? So only about a third of people, and there's obviously, sadly, a ton of research with combat vets that it's the same finding. So we want to also just shore up resources and help somebody get to that 4 to 6 week point and see, do you need additional intervention? So I don't know of any studies that affirm, but my belief would be like debriefing or other sort of trauma counseling approaches are really effective when someone's a month or a little more out and they are still really destabilized. At that point, the evidence I'm aware of says that it's really never harmful at that point to really ask them to say, hey, look, you need to start talking about this. And I can get into all the trauma psychotherapy principles, but it basically is we help them re-experience it in a productive therapeutic way. It cuts the link between those memories and the amygdala, and it slowly over time reduces that arousal and hypervigilance. And that's the kind of work you would see with somebody that has workplace trauma and stress. But the key point there is it's not a bad thing. It's about the timing and a little bit about the audience. And then the question about who should do it. I mean, ideally, I know in our region, we have horrible employee assistance programs for our healthcare workers. They all are these for-profit companies that we farm out to, and they're just awful. And I know that because when I used to do private practice, I would get nurses and physicians and people that would come to me and pay out of pocket to get some help because they weren't. So my first answer is, you probably need to have an external partner that's attached to their insurance, but I think it needs to be a little more curated, like a partner that's a mental health provider that you feel like actually has training in this, an interest in this. Make them come in and do a dog and pony show for you. You know, I know our police right now, I'm working with them on they want to get a new EAP provider. And I had a meeting with their current one and they told me, put them through the ringer. And I met with them and not a single thing in this presentation would those folks have been able to talk about. And not that I'm the expert, but I said, you need to find somebody who honestly has a passion for working with professionals that are impaired and struggling. And they're out there. They're absolutely out there. So.
Thank you. Let's see. Another question we had was, do you have any suggestions for leaders who want to evaluate what systematic changes are needed, or if individual employee strategies are more important?
Yeah, so I think I've done a lot of this for free, and I don't like doing it for free. And people that do it, I don't like doing it for free. But you know, I'm a mental health professional. We're just suckers. So, but what I've done with agencies is just taken my skills that I'm a PhD, you know, applied research skills, help them do usually qualitative data first. Focus groups, some individual interviews, not with everybody, but to get a sense of what the issues are, and then help them develop an anonymous survey. And then that usually leads to a pretty robust set of data from a needs assessment point of view that you can act on as a clinical lead. And we've done that a lot. So my advice would be find your favorite psychologist at U of N and see if they're interested in this. And they don't have to be great at this. They just have to be somebody interested in program evaluation. And you guys have some amazing resources up there actually for that. And I would say try to partner a contract. Sometimes you could do it with academics and they don't need money as long as you'll let them keep the data. They can write on it, for example. But that would be the first step. My main advice is do not, the thing I've done the most is I'll come in and do one workshop on something like this. And people will say, wow, that's so relevant. And then they'll ask this question. I'll say, I'm not double dealing. Don't hire me. I can, in our region, I can tell you some other people who'd love to help you. And then they never do that. Then they ask me to come back 6 months later and do the same workshop again. And I talk to the same, you know, glassy eyed people again. And then they ask me, how would we do this? And I tell them the same. So that's my only critique is like, you got to find somebody that's a consultant. It shouldn't cost you an arm and a leg, but to come in and really help you do a needs assessment over a period of 3 months or something and give you some good baseline data.
Well, it looks like, Trey, we've got two questions left and 2 minutes left. So I'm going to hit you with these pretty quick.
Yeah.
One of them is, do you think the lack of human interaction, such as handshakes, hugs, smiling, being in person, do you think that's significantly increased trauma within our health colleagues?
I think the way to put it is it's a natural inoculant against trauma, right? I don't know that the lack of that is causing the trauma or increasing it, but it's increasing it because it's a natural inoculant and we've had to remove it, you know? I'm in a space now, like our state's numbers we have the worst vaccination rate in the whole country. But the human impulse is so, because people have been vaccinated. So, I mean, I got this today, four people that we have students leaving for residency. They want to hug you. You know, they want, it's, they've had 5 years working with you, and they, and I said, let's do the elbow bump or something. But, you know, that anybody that's struggling, that's not helping at all. And I always think back to a guy named Harry Harlow that did research with monkeys. Maybe you heard about this, and he gave the monkeys a wire monkey mother and a fake mother that was covered in carpet. And those monkeys, you know, the wire mother had food on her, and the fur mother didn't. And they would go eat the food from the wire mother, but then immediately go back to the mother covered in fur. So, I mean, we're mammals. It's definitely a real thing. It's not some loosey-goosey observation. It's very real. And I think it's a natural inoculant that we can't fully access right now. So.
Okay, so final question we have, and this I think is especially relevant for Nebraska, is how can an emergency manager work on preventing burnout? I don't know if you're familiar, Trey, but yeah, we had pretty bad flooding in 2019. And so a lot of the emergency managers and everybody in the state really are still dealing with 2019 floods, and then COVID hit. So how do they deal with preventing burnout?
I think, yeah, my answer on this, I don't know that everybody I know in this would agree. I think a lot of the answer is, oh, you just need to have a proactive, preemptive. I don't know that that's actually necessary. A lot of the research with professionals is that they do have generally good organic skills. Like, they know the job they're in. They know, it's not that they don't know the risks. That usually is okay. Generally, the problem becomes once you have an exposure. So for us down here, the really hard one was the BP oil spill. It wasn't, you know, a direct life-threatening event, but we had the suicide rate quadrupled in our four county metro area. And I think it caught people by surprise. So if it's something that is totally out of the blue, yeah, you can't plan for that. But my point would be what I said earlier about really take a look at when the injury hits, so to speak, where would my workers go? Who would they go to? Do I have a relationship with whoever that is? So most of the work I do, when I ask people, what is your workers' insurance? Do you know who they would go to? If you had a large brace event, could you reach out to that insurance provider and have them come to your work and do a dog and pony show about what's available? Have the actual therapists that work for them that would see those clients, because they'll do that. They'll come out to you and say, we'll put together an outreach. And that almost never happens, almost never. And it's such a common sense thing. So I don't think you have to like have a lot of preventative things necessarily. You have to be doing what emergency managers know how to do, is what is our protocol from a human resource point of view when we take the hit? And do we have relationships with those providers where we have trust in them? The last thing people think about in most industries is who's going to provide mental health care to their workforce when something bad happens. I mean, obviously I'm biased. I wish we thought about that more, but particularly in this line of work, I just think it makes a lot of sense to build relationships, know who they're going to go to. So for example, I'll end on this. I'm privileged. That's what I do. So I'm in a mid-level executive position now, and I have 60 people that report to me. And this year I've had two people with major COVID-related, you know, mental health issues. And it's not like I tell them, call this 1-800 number. Yeah, there's a 1-800 number. We have an insurance. But I also tell them, let me give you the card of the two psychologists that are on our insurance panel that have an abiding interest in working with stress, burnout, stuff like that. And then let me send an email to that person and CC you with your permission. It's the warm handoff in healthcare, right? I think we got to do that in from a personnel point of view if possible too.
Well, thank you, Trey. I so appreciate you coming to speak to our group today. I think this was an excellent presentation.
Yeah, it was really fun.
Thank you. And we've got this recorded, so we'll put the recording up. Let me share my screen real quick. Just so everyone recalls, we have four more sessions coming up. You'll see what those are here. The next one will be on Tuesday. It's going to be Judy Plasek talking about burn care and burn plan development. Should be a great session. And we hope to have you guys for all those future sessions. So with that, I think we will close. Thank you guys so much. And I hope everyone has a great rest of their day.
Thank you all. Thanks for having me.